Hi everyone, and today in this lecture I am going to talk about polymerase chain reaction, which is abbreviated to PCR in short. The polymerase chain reaction is the basis of many modern molecular biology and molecular genetics techniques. And in just a few hours, PCR can amplify a single DNA molecule of your interest to a million fold. And a big thanks to Carrie B. Mullis for inventing this technique. And he awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1993 for inventing this revolutionary technique called polymerase chain reaction. Now, polymerase chain reaction, or simply you call it as PCR, it is a laboratory technique whereby DNA molecules in a sample are amplified or copied to make multiple copies of DNA. And this technique has a number of uses. For example, you can make more DNA from a very small amount in a sample. This is the first use. And the second use is, in addition, you can use this technique called PCR to determine if DNA is present by seeing if it amplifies via this technique. This is the second use. And the third use is, you can also determine the amount of DNA by seeing how quickly it amplifies. For instance, if you start with lots of DNA, it will amplify rapidly, and if you start with very little DNA, it will amplify slowly. These are the uses of this technique, right? Now, so let's see how polymerase chain reaction works. So firstly, we need to get a DNA amplifier machine or PCR machine called thermocycler. And then what we do is, we take a test tube, and into the test tube we put a standard PCR reaction mixture. This PCR reaction mixture consists of a sample, nothing but the original piece of DNA template, or you can say it as DNA of interest. And along with the sample, it also consists of number of other ingredients like thermostable DNA polymerase. See, these are the enzymes that will copy the DNA, and later on I will tell you what do you mean by thermostable DNA polymerase. And now, thermostable DNA polymerase, to work, it requires an oligonucleotide primer. In other words, primer is also called as a short stretch of nucleic acids, or you can also call it as a short DNA sequence, or simply you say it as a short piece of DNA, which is complementary to flanking regions of our target DNA sequence. You just Google it up. What do you mean by flanking, right? And DNA polymerase not only requires this oligonucleotide primer to work, but it also requires deoxynucleotide triphosphates, or you can call it as DNA bases, or simply you say it as nucleotides, right? So DNA polymerase requires two things: oligonucleotide primer, and it also requires nucleotides to copy the DNA. And lastly, we need a reaction buffer. So in a nutshell, we need a PCR machine called thermocycler, and then we take a test tube containing PCR reaction mixture, which includes sample or original DNA template, followed by thermostable DNA polymerase, oligonucleotide primer, deoxynucleotide triphosphates or DNA bases, and lastly, reaction buffer. The way that PCR works is, you put all those ingredients into a tube, and then you heat and cool the tube. This is called a cycle. And after each cycle, the amount of DNA in that tube is going to doubles up, right? And you know that PCR has three stages. It works in three stages. So the first stage is denaturation, which is carried out at high temperatures, that is 95 degrees Celsius. The second stage is annealing, which is carried out at low temperatures, that is around 55 degrees Celsius. And the third and final stage is elongation or extending or synthesis stage, which is done at intermediate temperatures, 72 degrees Celsius. So the first stage in a PCR cycle is to heat the mixture up to 95 degrees Celsius. And this causes denaturation of the double-stranded DNA template into a single-stranded DNA by breaking the hydrogen zip present in the middle of double-stranded DNA, right? Now, we cool down the mixture to 55 degrees Celsius, resulting in primer binding to the complementary single-stranded DNA templates, and this is called primer annealing. Now the temperature is slightly raised to a polymerase activation temperature, that is 70 to 72 degrees Celsius, to initiate chain elongation, because thermostable DNA polymerase work best at these temperatures, and we repeat this process in cycles, and each cycle generates more DNA. I know you are thinking that can DNA polymerase withstand all these high temperatures? See, actually when you put the normal DNA polymerase at 96 degrees Celsius, it denatures not only your double-stranded DNA to single-stranded, but it also denatures your DNA polymerase. So you know, we humans are so intelligent. So as to overcome this problem, some people during very hot conditions, they went to Yellowstone National Park and isolated DNA polymerase from a very special type of thermostable bacterium living there called Thermus aquaticus, or you can also call this bacterium as Thermophilus aquaticus, which can be abbreviated to TAQ in short, right? So this DNA polymerase can be called as TAQ DNA polymerase, Thermus aquaticus DNA polymerase, or thermostable DNA polymerase, and we use this type of DNA polymerase to drive the PCR reaction, right? In elongation phase, the DNA polymerase catalyzes the addition of free nucleotides to the three prime ends of the primers, and these nucleotides are added in complementary fashion to the template sequence. For instance, A with T and C with G. And elongation continues for about 1 minute and is terminated by cycling back to step one of the reaction, heating the temperature to 95 degrees Celsius, resulting in stand separation. So here's a picture from the web. Just to make this very clear, on the left side of the picture, we have our initial ingredients. The green structure is the original DNA to be replicated. The red structure is the primer, and the blue is the nucleotides. If you see here, we are heating the mixture and the DNA denatures, as we see right here, and we then cool it slightly so that the primer anneals, and again we then warm it so that the DNA polymerase begins elongating the strands, and you can see here that now we are going to get two DNA strands where we begin with only one DNA strand, right? We then repeat that process in another cycle. So at the end of this cycle, we go to 2 double-stranded DNA to 4 double-stranded DNA, and then we can repeat that cycle again, where at the end we will go from 4 double-stranded DNA to 8 double-stranded DNA. And you can see that how you very rapidly get lots of DNA even from a tiny amount in an initial sample. See, for every cycle, the total double-stranded DNA are doubled. So after the nth cycle, how many double-stranded DNA are you going to get? So the answer is 2 power n double-stranded DNA, right? Now it's easy to imagine from that last picture how a small amount of DNA can be amplified by PCR. But another use of PCR is to quantify the amount of DNA in a sample. And this is done by a variant of PCR called real-time quantitative PCR, which is abbreviated to qPCR in short. In this case, PCR is done in the presence of a fluorescent dye, and the amount of dye that's taken up is proportional to the amount of DNA in a sample. So if there's more DNA, there's more fluorescence, right? So the way this is done is, the amount of fluorescence is detected as PCR is ongoing. If there's a rapid increase in fluorescence, this means the initial sample contained more DNA. And if there is a lesser rise in fluorescence over time, it means the initial DNA sample had a relatively small amount of DNA. Now, PCR has lots of uses in research, but I have listed some of the clinical uses of PCR. And the thing you want to remember about these clinical uses is PCR is used in situations where you have very small amounts of DNA. Usually that is not part of a chromosome. And this is usually used to seek out and identify small amounts of DNA that might be circulating in tissues or plasma. So one use along those lines is to diagnose herpes simplex virus encephalitis. See, herpes simplex is a DNA virus, and in patients who have encephalitis from this virus, there will be small amounts of herpes simplex DNA in the cerebrospinal fluid, and you can use polymerase chain reaction to amplify those small amounts of herpes simplex DNA and make the diagnosis, right? PCR can also be used to measure an HIV viral load. Now this may seem confusing to you because you may know that HIV is an RNA virus. However, to use PCR for viral load measurement, the enzyme reverse transcriptase is used to make a copy of the virus's RNA, and this is called cDNA, and then you can use PCR to amplify that cDNA, and the amount of cDNA produced over time indicates the viral load, as we just discussed for quantitative PCR, and this is one of the standard tools for monitoring viral load in HIV patients. Right, and this concludes our discussion on polymerase chain reaction. If you like this lecture, please share this lecture, and if you are not yet subscribed to my channel, please do subscribe to my channel for more interesting concepts, and we meet in the next lecture with an interesting concept. Till then, stay tuned. Bye bye. Thank you.